be entertaining.
Welcome to Message Monday. Christian men, Christian walk, Christian talk. With your hosts, Tony Briscoe and Gary Dotson. We discuss faith, marriage, family, parenting, politics, and mental health, world news, and most of all, faith again. Let's go. Welcome to Message Monday.
What's up? What's up? What's up, beautiful people? I got some adjusting to do to my camera, but I'm going to leave it as is right now. I don't want to touch it. I'm going to leave it as is. What's happening? It's your boy, Tony B, rocking solo tonight. Thank y'all for tuning in to Message Monday, Christian men, Christian walk, Christian talk, where the women are always welcome. Thank y'all for coming on. May God bless tonight. Got a few things I do want to talk about and discuss. On tonight, I will caution folks, my emotions are super high, and we'll get into that in a little bit. But I do want to talk about some things. But as always, you know, if y'all got a prayer request, man, just drop it in the comments. We'll make sure that gets covered in prayer. I'm asking for prayer specifically for, mental health. You know, I've just my emotions have been pretty high lately because I got just a lot going on. There are things I'm trying to accomplish and working on taking it a day at a time, a piece at a time. But, you know, life can get overwhelming sometimes. And this phone ringing in the background is super irritating, too. But I say all that to say that's my prayer request for my people out there who tune in and who watch the show. Other than that, man, Lord, thank you for bringing me here on tonight. A few things to talk about on tonight. But I pray that the people had a great day. I pray that you were acknowledged in their lives on this day. I pray you've kept them and that you're strengthening them, Lord. You know the deep-rooted family issues that all of us have because life will always be lifing. I pray you meet us where we are and help us break curses that have been on our families for generations and help us seek you and see you in all things, Father. It is in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So I'm happy to be here tonight. We may have some guests coming on. I don't know. Sister Tina Phillips, see, man, her show was rocking tonight. I said, hey, bring that energy over here to my side of town so we can talk about this whole Adam and Eve thing. But do want to acknowledge it is Women's History Month 2024. So give a shout out to the ladies in your life. Give a shout out to the women in your life. Give a shout out to the queens who are out there doing their thing. Give a shout out to all the ladies out there who are making history. But don't forget to acknowledge and include the ones that are in your life. So every household I've lived in has been dominated by women. So that's why I get real protective of sisters. Every household I lived in was ran by a woman, from my grandmother to however short period of time I stayed with my biological mother, to my cousin Arlene, whose birthday was last week, God rest her soul, to Joyce Craft, to my cousin Trisha Young, to Linda Williams, to Mother Wells. Like, you know, it's just been women, you know. And so shout out to all the ladies, Mother Wells. No, I love you like crazy, so I don't need to say more about that. But yeah, let's give a shout out to the ladies in our lives and also those ladies that are making history. You know, growing up, being a writer when I got older, and I'm talking in spoken word format, like, I don't recall learning of, I remember Maya Angelou. I don't remember learning of Gwendolyn Brooks. Clearly one of, or, you know, I remember Lorraine Hansberry from one play, but not any much after that, right? You get the highlights, some highlights in school, but, you know, knowing the length of the, I don't know what to call it, arsenal or whatever they had, their entire writing career, just to acknowledge those women who were doing great things out there in the writing community. Spoken word is still very much alive and well in the city of Chicago. There's an open mic for almost everybody, every genre you name. There's an open mic for it from the north side to the south suburbs. Plenty of work out here. And there are a lot of ladies out there who are doing some great poetic things. If y'all have never heard of Sister Kendria, if I'm saying her name correctly, her name is K Love. Google K Love. You will see some bars come up. Another young lady, a woman doing her thing in Chicago for years named Emrail Green. A lot of dynamic artists out there. My sister Analog Soul, who's been in stage plays, is in a play now. Just a lot of dynamic work being done by women. So it's easy to pick the Kamala Harris's. It's easy to pick those. Our sister who's serving on the Supreme Court, her name eludes me right now. But it's easy to pick them. I think Sister Katanji. But acknowledge the women who are in your life now. Acknowledge them for what they bring to the table for you daily. So I did want to start the show by acknowledging our Women's History Month. And if we're coming off of Black History Month, but like my sister D Dotson told me, Black History is 365. It's not a month. It's 365. If you don't know, my man Eddie Phillips from the Erudition Network has just released a book. You can find it on Lulu. Let me go ahead and matter of fact, let me rock on my Kindle real quick so I can pull it up. So I can let y'all know what the name of this book is so y'all can support my brother. All right. It is called 101. The Erudition Network presents 101. Black History Question Challenge, Early World by Eddie K. Phillips. You can find that on lulu.com. Yes, it's $18. Yes, you need to invest in my brother because we spent a whole lot of money on a whole lot of stuff. I know because I had some Chick-fil-A today. I know I brought a salad. I'm going to eat my salad for lunch tomorrow. I didn't eat the salad today. I did have my apples, though. I had my apples. All right. So, again, the Erudition Network presents 101 Black History Question Challenge, 101, excuse me, Black History Question Challenge, Early World by Eddie K. Phillips of the Erudition Network. So if you tune in on Thursday nights at 7 o'clock, Eddie comes on. You can also look up the Erudition Network, his YouTube channel, like and subscribe. But he teaches all about African history, African-American history. He kind of incorporates both of those into his teaching style. But Eddie is highly intellectual. He digs a lot into history. So don't be offended if you run across names you don't know. Don't worry about that. Just go ahead and support my man. Let me get the light out the way so y'all can see that a little bit. There you go. In the camera. There you go. So just support my brother and the work that he's doing to educate our people. A few things I want to talk about tonight. And why are my emotions high? I don't know. I go through moods, man. Like that's just how it is with me. I go through moods, right? And I realize, you know, I really believe that the Lord is just dealing with me. And until I get to a place where I want to fast and hear from him, I'll probably be feeling this way. So, you know, when you got to fast and hear from him, you know, sometimes you don't want to. But, you know, you can't run from him. He's everywhere. He's listening right now. He knew I was hopping on. But, yeah, I think I just got to get to a quiet place, man. I got some pressures on me that is causing me some stress. If stress is unhandled, it leads to depression. When depression is not dealt with, it leads to isolation. Isolation is where the enemy wants us. He doesn't want us around anybody who can lift us up. He doesn't want us to share. So keep those things in mind. I want to talk about a few things on tonight. I want to talk about why women should not try to own men's emotions. I want to talk about trying to fix a car when you grow up with no dad. And I want to talk about helping millennial men prepare for marriage. So those are the things that I want to discuss tonight. Please share the feed, share it on your Facebook page. If you're chiming in on YouTube, share it on YouTube. And let's get in. So why women should not try to own men's emotions. The reason I'm talking about this is because I get irritated when I see our daughters manipulated by men. And so when it comes to relationships. On marriage.com, it talks about if you're in a situation, and I'm speaking specifically to women, where you feel your significant other or your spouse is continuing to blame you for things, I think those are signs of caution. If a man is asking you, I should say, you know, I'm talking to a Christian audience, so, you know, you can date, be a Christian without having sex. So I can talk to those who are dating. I could talk to those who are married in the same regard. There are things that you should engage in when it comes to relationships before you enter in, Queens. One of those things is an understanding of your husband's or your future husband's upbringing. You have to understand the dynamic of how that man was raised. Now, once you understand how the man you're going to be married to was raised, and if you're married now and it was just things you didn't know, it's impossible for us as men to let you know everything about us. One of those reasons is we are still learning and we're still growing on our own. There are some things that are blotted out from certain experiences that we've had growing up. So bear with me for a minute, though. Bear with me for a minute. One of the things you have to look beyond when dating. So if you're engaged right now, this is perfect timing for you. It's perfect timing because now you're equipped with tools to go back and ask your future husband. Or if you're a brother who's watching, it's for you to go ask your future wife. You have to have an understanding of upbringing, right? So me being raised by all women, whatever house I stayed in, I was used to women running everything. So it was easy for me to sit back and let women take charge and let women take control because that's how I came up. I didn't stay one place long enough to become anybody's mama's boy, but that's how I came up. So there was a certain extent. This is why I don't have a problem with women who are in leadership roles. I don't have a problem with women who are CEOs. I don't have a problem with women who I had to report to because I was used to women running things in every household I've lived in. So it was zero issue for me for a woman to be in charge. I grew up like that. So that was a natural occurrence for me. So it was never an issue of ego. Well, why she got that job? She ain't no man. She'll need to be in that position. No, I grew up being raised by all women. So women in position and authority, I was kind of used to, almost welcomed it, more so than I did for a long time, men who were in leadership. That's a whole nother show. I got to do that with my brother because I'm going to need some backup when I start engaging these things, right? Sister, you should know the background of the man you're getting ready to marry. You should know his upbringing. Doesn't mean dump him if you don't like what you hear. What I'm saying is you get an early understanding of how a man manages his emotions. You're going to find out later who you can find out. You're going to find out one way or the other because, you know, we're emotional. I was looking at a study, man. I didn't pull the link up. Darn it. I had a link for y'all so I could share the data. But they had 142 men and women, half and half. They put them through, you know, they do these studies, right? They do these studies. They had 142 people. They had men, they had women, and they had the women taking something to offset the menstrual cycle. So they had women who were on their menstrual cycle. They had men who were just being men. I don't think they didn't get a man any drugs, but they had women who were on a menstrual cycle and women who were on medication to offset their menstrual cycle. It's some drugs out there that can do that. I just want y'all to know that. But this study turns out, it finds out that women were no more emotional than men. Now, they, you know, they come up with these numbers by doing a sample, first of all. So I don't know if 100, for me, 142 people and split that in half is not enough because I need to know what demographic did you do. They didn't give data points on whether they were African American, Latino American. They didn't do any of that stuff. So take the data with a grain of salt. But let's just go with what I saw. If it's factual that in this study of 142 people, let's just take the study for what it said it is, that the men were no more, that the women were no more emotional than men, even when they were on their menstrual cycle, their monthly period, right? So when you're getting into a relationship, you have to know the right questions to ask to draw out what, how that man will respond to things. What do I mean by that? Well, I'm going to expose myself. When I got married, I had a whole, I was angry before I got married. I was angry after I got married, but my anger had nothing to do with my wife, right? It had nothing to do with her. So there were just certain things I would just like yell about for zero reason. Like it could be something small, basic conversation. I was just a yeller, right? I grew up in a household that was a lot of yelling to get things done. You know, it was, you woke up in the morning, good morning, good morning. You know, everything was just like kind of always intense. So I carried that with me. And so, so that's what I want to say. I'm sorry, I saw a comment come in here. Ms. Phillips says, hey, Tony, I think women didn't get the chance to claim being emotional, but because men don't normally admit to being emotional, they just automatically assume women are more emotional. No, that's, I got zero issue with that comment, Sister Phillips. That is 100% spot on. So when it comes to men and emotions, it is not the responsibility of our daughters, of you as a woman, as a fiance, as a girlfriend, or woman friend, or as a married woman, to own the emotions of your spouse or your significant other. That's our job as men, to own our emotions. I had to learn that. How did I learn that? It had to come through counseling. And I mean professional counseling. I'm not just talking about talking to somebody and calling up. I mean, you know, I worked at a hospital for, I want to say a good 9 years. And so I had access to clinical psychologists who I became friends with, who I could talk to about, you know, these things, to work these things out. So, it still took time after all of that. But I'm saying I had people in my life that could equip me with tools. I had to learn to dissect and dig into the proverbs, the Psalms, that talk about how our emotions should be submitted to the word of God, so I could submit that. So even in my anger, it wasn't about wanting to speak better to my wife. It was, but I want to get you to get this first. I had to learn to speak right to her because of my relationship with God. In order to get right with her, I had to get right with him. It is not your job to manage a man's emotions at all. Never forget that. Eddie says, men created the word and definition of hysteria. The history of that terms are actions done and are deep in culture. Yeah, you know, that's the scholar I got on the line. That's Eddie Phillips. Eddie, I just told them about your book too. I just shared with them the cover of your book, 101 Black History Questions, 100 Question Challenge. I just shared it with them. I told them they can go on lulu.com to go and get that. They can go to the Erudition Network to go and get that. What's up, Brother Eric? How you doing, man? All right, Eric, great to see you, man. You're very welcome, Eddie. So this is conversations, and I'm not betraying any confidence, but it's been over time that I've gotten a call from a young lady who was like, yo, I really like this person, but I don't want to own their reactions to me. And I was like, well, give me a little bit more detail. Oh, you know, well, if I'm in a certain mood or I'm feeling a certain way, they're easily offended by it and they just kind of get out of control. And I'm like, well, define out of control for me, because when you say out of control, I need to make sure that nobody's putting their hands on you as a brother, first of all. That's the first thing we need to do, right? But it's just relationship stuff. And I'm talking about the basic relationship stuff. Like, I know domestic violence occurs. If it is, I'm going to tell every woman or every man who's dealing with it, get safe. right? But dealing with it on a level, there was nothing my wife could do or say to get my emotions under control. It wasn't her job to. For a long time, early in our marriage, and I would say probably the first, maybe the first 2.5 years, I know she walked on eggshells, right? If she cooked something I didn't like, it was a, why you make this? If it was, you know, she washed a certain thing a certain way, why you wash it like this? It was just like, just real childish stuff. But again, my anger was stemming from everything I had carried over the years. And typically that person that is loving you is going to be the one that gets the brunt of all that hurt until you get help. Right. So this is why I'm sharing transparently. And this is where I'm sharing openly, because I want our daughters to get a grasp of things that you don't have to own in a relationship and things that you should not try to own. Emotional men who are yellers, and we're all emotional. So I don't want to emasculate any man. Like, we're all emotional, right? We just, everybody handles their emotions differently. That's all it is. And so I don't want to, I'm not emasculating any brothers. I love brothers. I love the men. This show is for men, Christian men. So I love my brothers, but I'm helping us own our stuff, and I'm helping us own our stuff by sharing why I fell short. And sometimes I may still fall short in that area, but I've just learned now, if I've got to blow up, I need to be calm and speak soft, because a soft answer turns away wrath. A fool speaketh his mind, but a wise man considers all of his words. Even a fool knows how to be wise when he knows when to shut his mouth. And so these are all the things that I had to incorporate into my life to bring my emotions subject to the word of God, so I would not offend his daughter. So if you're in a relationship, and again, I'm talking to our daughters, but man, you could apply it in reverse. If you are in a relationship where someone is saying that the reason they are the way they are is because of you, that's a passing of ownership. Now, I'm in the cybersecurity. I can pass responsibility down to my team member by delegating. I cannot pass down accountability. Accountability is on the owner. That is me. That is men. We cannot say that because she did this, I responded this way. No, you can say because she did this, I chose to respond this way. Again, we got to own our stuff. So ladies, do not allow us as men to avoid our responsibility and our accountability to ourselves for how we handle our emotions. And this stuff takes work. It takes a lot of work. My sister Tina Phillips cares about me a lot. She knows I can get excited in 2.5 seconds, right? She knows, like, and that's not that everything is triggers. I'm just an exciting dude when I start talking about things, right? But my sister is very sensitive. So she says, I'll be responsible for what I share with Tony because I don't want Tony to lose it. But if Tony loses it, that's not Sister Tina's fault. That's Tony's fault. I'm accountable for my actions. So if you're in an early phase of dating, or if you just got engaged and you have not done any type of premarital counseling, I know some people don't believe in it. That's their business. I'm a firm believer in it. If you've not done any premarital counseling, you're not going to have the tools necessary to be able to dissect what's going on in the mind of that person that you're getting ready to marry. You see signs. The signs are there. But you can get intimidated in bringing these things up because you don't want to deal with it. Well, the problem is when you don't deal with it, it doesn't make it go away in marriage. It amplifies it. It turns it up a notch. And those are the things that you want to be able to work on avoiding until you're able to deal with it. Now, you are not going to get rid of everything. We were 21 years into marriage when certain things started, you know, coming out with my wife. I ain't gonna say what those things are out of privacy. And it's not deep, but she's not here to let me say I can share it. But it was just like, man, we've been together 21 years. Where this come from? Oh, such and such and such and such. I was like, oh, snap, man. That's after 21 years. So you're not going to cover everything. But you want to be able to ensure that in your place as a woman, you only can own your stuff. On Sister Tina's show, Android Living, that comes on an hour before this at 6 o'clock, man, she was hitting it all today. Like her comment field was blowing up, talking about Adam and talking about Eve, right? And she owned her part, but I'm on the side of her. Nothing changed until Adam ate. Adam is accountable for that. Adam got a hold of that. You did that, bruh. You allowed this. I don't call it a snake. Whatever this beautiful thing was at the time, it was attractive enough to get attention. But for Adam has to own and be accountable. And God made him accountable for that. There was some responsibility that fell on Eve, and God dealt with her accordingly. I think he dealt with Eve a little bit harder than he dealt with Adam. I'm just going to say that, but that's just me, Lord. No disrespect. Okay, don't judge me on that. But it was a reminder for her. But I say that to say, sometimes emotion in men, well, let me just say what marriage.com says. Why do people blame others? 7 reasons. Marriage.com said, 1, and it didn't say men, it says people. So I want you to keep it in that context. 1 reason is to avoid responsibility. I quote, blaming others can serve as a defense mechanism to avoid taking responsibility for one's actions or decisions. It allows the individual to shift the focus away from their own shortcomings or mistakes. End quote. Reason number 1, avoiding responsibility. Number 2, preserving self-esteem. Blame can be a way for individuals to protect their self-esteem by attributing negative outcomes to external factors for other people. They maintain a positive self-image and avoid feelings of inadequacy. Man, now that sounds like a whole word, doesn't it? That's some really important stuff right there. Now, here's where the other part comes in. Their number 3 reason. Control and power dynamics. Blaming others may be a tactic to exert control over power in relationships. By assigning blame, individuals may manipulate situations to gain the upper hand or maintain dominance. So if I'm blaming my wife for things, if I'm blaming my significant other for things that I know I play a role in, if I blame them, I can manipulate how they feel and respond. And for a man who's dominant, that manipulation can fall into making you feel bad so we can further coerce you into getting what we want. That's a control and power dynamic. Now, I will add, women do this 100% better than men. You know, we kind of black and white, you know. Tina says, I think the real basis is that people don't like accepting accountability for negative things, so they try to avoid it. Absolutely. And if they don't, and they try to avoid that by shifting the blame onto the other person. One of the ways of doing that, I know y'all heard this. It's not you, it's me. Which is in essence saying is you, not me. I love you. I'm just not in love with you. Right? Accountability, power dynamics that fall into that. Another reason others get blamed, they say number 4, is fear of consequences. The fear of facing consequences for one's actions can drive blame. Admitting fault may be perceived as threatening, leading individuals to deflect blame to avoid potential repercussions. Now, if you in corporate America, this should resonate with you well. It should resonate with you well, right? People don't like to take accountability. They like to pass it on. In relationships, it can happen just as much. Excuse me. And sometimes it can happen because people are just overwhelmed with life. They don't have an outlet. They don't know how to process these things. And so things really blow up when over a period of time, these things get high versus being able to deal with it and handle it right there in the moment. These things pile up, and that's what allows those things like that to build up when it comes to fear of consequences. Right? Tina said, reverse psychology. It's not you, it's me. Oh yeah, you know, you already know. Reason number five, and then I'll move on to the next topic after I get through these last two. Reason number five. Don't move, screen. Lack of empathy. Now that's an interesting. It says some individuals may struggle with empathy, making it difficult for them to understand or acknowledge the impact of their actions on others. Blaming becomes a way to distance themselves from the emotions of those they affect, those that they impact. Absolutely. I agree with that. Sympathy means, hey, I feel sorry for you. Holla back. Empathy means I've got to get in relationship with you. Empathy means I have to be involved with you. Empathy means I've got to line up next to you and experience what you experience. So sympathy just means, hey, I know you starving. Man, I'm sorry you hungry, bro. I apologize, man. Like, man, have a good day. That's sympathy. Empathy says, I know you hungry. I've been where you are. Let me get you something to eat. There's a difference in relationship when it comes to having that type of empathy in relationships, right? And this is, a lot of couples miss this. A lot of folks can just be really dismissive to what a spouse is dealing with. Because, and it's not that they want to, sometimes they just don't know how to relate or deal with it, right? It happens. Number six, and I led to this, coping with stress. During times of stress or crisis, people may resort to blaming as a coping mechanism. It provides a temporary outlet of frustration and helps individuals manage overwhelming emotion. That's why you got to have understanding of the person that you're going to spend the rest of your life with, how they process things. So if I'm a yeller, which I know I can be, I got to kill that immediately. Now, people will say, well, you can't just be silent. You can be silent if you need to get calm before you can have a conversation. You have to. Now, I mastered that early on with the wife and thought I was good. Then when that teenager came, Lord have mercy. Jeez, woo! Them teenagers, boy, they put you on a whole nother level of trying to control yourself. But again, you want to understand these things in these terms so you know what you're seeing when it happens. And this is the biggest one, number seven, and I'll close this segment on this. It says pattern of learned behavior. Growing up in an environment where blame is a common response to challenges or conflicts can contribute to learned behavior pattern. Individuals may adopt this approach as a way of navigating relationships based on their upbringing. Now, I'm just reading this one. What I tell y'all when I started off, you have to dig into how that person was raised, because if you don't dig into that, the pattern of learned behavior, most of what I brought into my marriage was learned behavior. I'd never seen a stable marriage outside of the people at church. I was never in the life of people who were married for a very long time consistently. I've been around my homies who've been divorced. I was a military man, and we talked about that a couple of weeks ago, where when I was in the military, my first trip to Italy, I worked in the office, and the average service jacket had three to five divorce decrees. Some of them things had seven. Some of them things, you had one file that could take up almost like 25% of a cabinet, right? So I'm in these environments and I'm surrounded a pattern of learned behavior. This is why we have to be walking in the fullness of the Lord so we can be curse breakers. I'm still trying to break curses, man. I'm still trying to break curses, psychological curses, mental curses, financial curses, emotional curses. Like, it's still so many things that I have to surrender to the Lord on a daily basis. And this is sometimes why it's hard to deal with God, because when you're dealing with him, there's nobody you can talk to. What am I gonna do? I can't quote, what am I, quote scripture? Satan messing with me. I can quote scripture. He got to back up. He got to bow to the word. When Jah is dealing with you, who am I going to go to? Right? It's these patterns of learned behavior. But guess what? The pattern of a learned behavior means it can be, you can be taught better. Your relationship can be better. You can have better conversations. So make no mistake, man, marriage is work, baby. And if you don't start putting in that work, my daughters in your relationship right now, or my sisters in your relationships right now, if you don't start putting in that work before you get married, it's going to be more work afterwards. Because I told you, marriage compounds complexities in relationships. Marriage is not a cure. Marriage is not a healing factor. Marriage will expose you in greater ways than your relationship can. Why? Because now you got to deal with the attack of the enemy who doesn't want you married in the first place. He doesn't want you in a stable household. He doesn't want you in a traditional marriage. So those seven things, understand them. I'll repeat them, then I'm moving on. Blaming others in relationships is due to, you want to avoid responsibility, preserve your own self-esteem. You want to be in control in the power dynamics, fear of consequences, lack of empathy, coping with stress. But they should have led with the pattern of learned behavior, because when you have the pattern of learned behavior, the six that they have in front of that all fall into that category. We do what we're taught. This is the thing with our young people. They do what they see. They don't do what they told. They do what they see. They do what they witness. And so that's the part I wanted to talk about with relationships. Thank y'all for the comments on those. And thank you. As my producer, I'm sticking to my time schedule. My producer watching. All right, next up. Now this one, y'all, this hit me on Saturday. Saturday was beautiful, beautiful. I was grateful to go for a nice long ride on Saturday. When I say long ride, it was just to the suburbs. But I had to meet someone to go pick up something, and I woke up late, so I left late, so I had to literally wait for them to get back. And that was like a good 45 minutes to an hour. So I just made some stops, made some runs to do some things. Trying to fix a car when you grow up with no dad. So my tail light had been out. My brake light had been out for a minute. I bought the bulb a while ago, just being lazy. Anyway, in my car, we're driving a few weeks ago, and it was raining. So my wife was like, "Can you see?" I was like, "You know, I'm having a hard time seeing at night. Like, why are you asking me that question?" She was like, "No, I mean your windshield wipers." I was like, "They fine." I didn't realize, y'all, I had been driving around with the windshield wipers when I bought this car in 2015. So I went and I got some windshield wipers. I'm going to tell y'all, I'm not going to sit here in front. I know everybody say it's easy to put these things on, but again, it goes back to when you don't have father figures in your life, these things can be intricate. For a cat like me, like, don't put a hammer in my hand. Don't give me no drill. And you want me to do your drywall, because your whole wall may just end up missing. Okay. I'm not that dude, but it was actually pretty easy to put the windshield wipers on. So I'm not going to talk about that, because that was pretty cool. And by the way, I can see when I drive with the windows now. It's crazy. You know, that's why you need wives in your life, man. Help me. Tina called it earlier. Help me. My challenge came in. It took me almost 35 minutes not to change the bulb. That was the easy part. It was getting the light fixture off the car. So I found the YouTube video and I'm doing everything this dude is saying, and it's not working. Because he's like, you got to be real careful. You don't want to break it. So eventually I did. I was able to get this piece off, got the bulb changed, got it back on, screwed it back in. And y'all felt like real good. But, you know, I talked to some of my guys who grew up with dads or uncles around. And they got something I don't have. That's why I miss my father-in-law, God rest his soul, Carl Newton, because that man taught me a whole lot. Taught me how to use a drill, taught me how to put in anchors, you know, taught me how to do measurements, taught me how to use a level. Like, he taught me so much. And I remember a couple of years ago, I had to go to Menard, and I was in Menard, and I just like, man, I wish my father-in-law was right here, because I wouldn't be struggling like I'm struggling. Somebody sends you down the aisle, like, okay, look down the aisle, and I'm stuck in the aisle, and I'm like, finally, I had to go get somebody. Like, hey, man, look, just walk me to what I need to see, bro, please. But it's the importance of men being in our lives. And what we're seeing in this day and age is the appearance. I'm not saying it's what it is, but the appearance of young men not growing up with father figures in their lives that are of a great influence. The process of manhood, if it's not embedded in childhood, you have a hard time navigating certain spaces as you get older. So when it comes to things like fixing a flat, changing a tire, all of these things, I've seen men shamed and judged for in public settings because of something that they did not know how to do. How can you blame a man for not knowing something if he was never taught it as a child? How can you blame a man for something that when you took all the trades out of schools where we could learn how to be auto mechanics, we could learn how to computer program, we could learn how to do drafting, we could learn how to be journeyman. You took all those programs out of schools that help young boys become men. You know, working with tools, not to get gender specific about it. I know some sisters who can run circles around brothers when they come to building stuff. We're not talking about that, but you had these foundational things that when you grew up. Now, fortunately, growing up in a church, I was able to piece a man together by other folks' dads. You know, I apologized to one of the sisters last week because I was sitting, we sit down at breakfast on occasion, and sometimes her mom is there. And I apologized. I said, you know what? What's your mom's last name? And she let me know. And I said, well, I called her mom a couple of weeks ago. I want to apologize for that. Why? Because I've been so used to calling, and this is no shade, I mean, no disrespect, but I've been so used to calling other people's mom's mom. Because I didn't have my own all my life. It just became a norm for me. Right? And so that I wanted to, like, I'm making a separation. And so, but again, when you have boys who are growing up without these foundational things. Now, I'm not a sports guy either. I'm not really into sports. I used to be into sports back in the day, but again, my homies didn't want me around. Why? Because of my emotions. Like, if the Bulls did something crazy, man, I was liable to break something, throw something, tear something up. They was like, oh, dude, we cannot watch the game with this dude at all. Yeah, I remember being in Virginia when I was in Little Creek, Virginia. We own the Navy base. We watching the Bulls game, and OJ interrupted the Bulls game, and I went bananas. They was like, hey, Briscoe, calm down, dude. I was like, nah, man, this don't make no sense. So, you know, when you don't have, I wasn't a sports guy for a long time. But learning how to fix things, be a repairman, doing things around the house, if you didn't grow up in that environment, it's really hard to stick to that. So coming back from Ghana, I had a whole different empathy for our young boys who were in gangs, especially our brothers on the old block that are down the street from my church. Like, I had an empathy for them because Ghana taught me post-traumatic slave syndrome. Eddie, am I allowed to say that? Let me know if I'm not. Post-traumatic slave syndrome. And what has been stripped of us was the essence of manhood, and for the queens, the essence of motherhood. And how through generations, I can't think of the scientific term for it, but trauma that passes down through generations. Sometimes we just don't know better and don't know how to do better, don't know how to be better. And I'm not labeling slavery as an excuse for the things that our young people do. Ancestral trauma is real, right? So I'm not trying to make this as an excuse for what our young people do or anything. But until you go to Ghana and step where I step and went where I went, then you'll understand what I'm talking about when I talk about when Eddie just says ancestral trauma. It's some real stuff. We missed out on a whole lot that was not taught to us. And so in comes now for our young people, the drug dealer. Oh man, young blood, I'll show you some love, man. Just go make this run for me. That becomes the go-to, right? Oh yeah, you got to go to that church stuff, man. Don't worry about that church stuff. And the church really gets a bad rap, but there are churches who are out there doing work and putting in work. Like, let's call that what it is. But our young men, what I witness in the schools, y'all know I got a new gig. I'm on campus walking last week. Now, UIC is a no smoke campus. You can't even smoke on the grounds. Not only were this group of brothers smoking, they weren't even smoking cigarettes. They were smoking weed. Like right there in the public and open on the campus grounds. Now, if somebody calls the police over there because y'all smoking weed outside, y'all gonna want to get mad and upset at the police. No. So that's another piece for you ladies. And it was something my wife said because she knew I was raised in a house with women, you know. And she know, you know, Mother Wells at, you know, top of that list, you know, like, you know, but she was like, yo, just let you know, like, I'm not raising no man. I'm like, I don't need you to raise me. I just need you to do everything the other women did in my life. You know, but it was still a part of my growing and my growth. I have zero issue being a man. I know how to lead. From watching other men to just who I am, period. Like, you know, God wrote things in my heart long before I started serving him. So I know how to be a man, how to love a woman. Now that's a different story that I had to grow into as well. So I just wanted to mention that, like, you know, for sisters, if you dating a man who don't know how to do certain things around the crib, you know, like, you know, take notes, but Maybe he didn't have a dad in his life. Maybe he didn't have a man in his life to show him. Maybe he didn't have an uncle in his life. So, you know, just have a little empathy, you know, in that regard. And again, like I'm not the greatest uncle in the world. You know, I've made some mistakes of being an uncle. You know, I wouldn't consider myself a top. I would even, if you had to rank me as an uncle, I'd probably put myself at a 2 or 3. I love my nieces and nephews. They ever need me, I will drop everything and do whatever I can for them. That's been proven. That's been shown. And that's known to this day. But, you know, life happens, man. And you just get caught up running by raising your own when you can't reach the other ones. You know, so again, I'm still trying to break curses. The last part of my show I want to talk about, and this is directly for young men. Millennial men who are not married. I want to be able to help you out a little bit. There are some things you need to do. Because if you're a millennial man, you're probably between the age of 37 and I'll say 40, going on 40. I try to share my life with young men because I don't want them to make mistakes that I've made. And my mistakes have primarily just been out of ignorance of not knowing, right? When it comes to being financially stable, when it comes to picking and choosing a career, when it comes to even entrepreneurship at some point, I want you to start preparing yourself for that which you want to see in your future. There are some things you should have ironed out. And if you don't have them ironed out, be careful watching social media, because social media has a way of making you feel like you've accomplished nothing. Social media is a right now, ready now, get it done real quick generation. So you got to be real cautious. And I would dare not say that this has been the cause of some of my mental health, because it's like in this day and age, if you don't have the business, the job, the $1 million in the bank account, the ready to retire by the time you're 52, if you don't have all these things in place, man, society can place pressure on you that is unprecedented, and you can get lost in that. What I do want you to start thinking about is your purpose. What I do want you to start thinking about, young brothers, is your career and your goals. And before you pop that question, what all that means for you and where do you want to be in your life? Now, there's a saying that's going around. It's been around for a while that has put women in the position where they want the perfect ready-made man. Again, I'm talking what social media is putting out there, right? I talked to some real down-to-earth sisters who not on social media, and they like, look, I just want somebody who's genuine, somebody who's saved, somebody who's genuine, and somebody who handles his business. That's it. Somebody who's saved, somebody who's genuine, and somebody that handles his business. And you have to meet the right one in order to do that, brothers. So I want you to think about some things. Where you are in your life, where you are in your career, where you are when it comes to living your best life right now. Eddie says, there's a reason you can't find, I don't know who Porgy and Bess are, Sporting Life was a drug dealer and sings the famous song, "It Ain't Necessarily So," to get black folks to not believe in God. Tina says three different. I'm gonna get you, Tina. Watch it. But I really want you guys to start thinking about, don't worry about where you are. Don't get lost in where you are. Find yourself in where you want to go. And that's going to require you to do some work, and that may require you to do some money, right? I went to a purpose course that was it was held by my man, Lionel Harris. It was great for me. This show is part of that work. I know what my purpose is. I can haul it off. My purpose is to glorify God by helping men and women who are bound with childhood issues and helping them write their deliverance through spoken word and the creative arts. That's my purpose. I get to do that through this show. I get to do that through sharing my poetry and my works and sharing my life. It may not be on the stages where I want it. It may not be in big auditoriums and forums where I like to have it, but I get to impact men through this show. I get to share through this show. I get to share through hip hop. I got two albums out there under The Endurer on iTunes. You want to hear some of the stuff I talk about? It's completely contrary to what you hear on the airwaves and on the radio nowadays. I keep it 100 and I keep it real. and it's all positive and your kids can listen to it, right? I'm an uplifter. That's what I do. But for the millennial men out there who are still single and who want to be in a place to be married, there's work to do. If you need help and assistance with that work, man, you got the Erudition Network. You got Man Up Real Talk on Fridays with my man, Mike. You got Erudition Network on Thursday nights. You got Message Mondays on Monday nights. Like, there's a whole lot that we can help guide you to help you on the right path. But you got to be ready to spend some money on the tools that help. Save that money on them Jordans that you want to collect. Put that money to the side and get a part of a program that can help you be the best you who you want to be. I don't believe that women are looking for a man who's perfect. They just want a man who's saved, a man who's genuine, and a man who takes care of business. They want a husband like that, right? That's what it is. I believe that's what a majority of our sisters want. I'm a dude, no woman intimidated me. Trust me, I proposed to enough of them. D, don't tell nobody that. Ooh, I just said it on the air, didn't I? But I say that to say, I wasn't intimidated by a woman. I didn't care. I didn't have a college degree. That meant absolutely nothing to me. I'm a holler at you, sister. You know, you ain't got yourself together. Well, define together for me. I'm working. I got my own spot. Well, you don't have a car. Nope, I don't have a car. I can take a bus to wherever you at, where you want to go. I'll meet you downtown. I'll take the bus home myself. You want to drive, you can do all that. We still going out? Nope. Okay, cool. No problem. I'm good. No woman intimidated me. None. Zero. I'm a man. I'm a man's man. When I met my wife, I had no car. What I had was relationship with two sisters, my girl LaVon and my girl Margaret. When I wanted to take my wife out, I borrowed their cars. They were like, sure, Tony. Matter of fact, keep it for the week. I'm going out of town. Me and the husband going out of town. Keep it. Great. Used to push that old Aurora Oldsmobile, baby. But I'm just saying, I made a way. I got you. Don't worry about it. So I say that to say, find out what your purpose is, brother. Stop comparing yourself to what you're seeing on social media. And that's a note back to myself, too. But my show has come to end. I started at 8:05. I'll be ending at 8:04. Thank y'all for tuning in. I appreciate y'all, family. Don't forget what we talked about tonight. Women, do not try and own your man's emotions. Get him in a place where he can figure that out for himself. Eddie was on the bus. I got on the bus. He paid, but I still married him. Hey, that's what I'm talking about. Love you too, cuz. Hey, man. Hey, first of all, cuz, thank you for sharing the testimony, man. A no brain tumor, bro. Like, thank you for posting that. Thanking that the Lord continue to watch over you, man, and keep you and strengthen you, bro. And just keep your head up, man, and keep moving and keep doing what you're doing, man. Love you. So that's the show for tonight, folks. I pray that the peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. It's your boy, Tony B. Thank y'all for tuning in to Message Mondays. Christian men, Christian walk, Christian talk, where the sisters are always welcome. I'm out of here.
Welcome to Message Monday. Christian men, Christian walk, Christian talk, with your hosts, Tony Briscoe and Gary Dotson. We discuss faith, marriage, family, parenting, politics, and mental health, world news, and most of all, faith again. Let's go. Welcome to Message Monday.